to the reciprocal lattice. And I will continue now this part. So I had also told you that the reciprocal lattice is a Bravais lattice. So I'm just repeating this part. So it is a Bravais lattice. Reciprocal lattice, which is generated by the primitive vectors . So this was about the reciprocal lattice. So it is a Bravais lattice generated by the primitive vectors B1, B2, and B3. And I had given you two equivalent equations for B1, B2, and B3, defining B1, B2, and B3. And one of them was Bi times Eg is equal to 2 pi delta ij, and I had given you also explicitly the vector b1, b2, and b3 as a function of a1, a2, and a3, and shown that it is equivalent to this definition and to the explicit form. Basically, they are unique. So you had seen also that B1, B2, and B3 were linearly independent. So I ask you to calculate the volume of the unit cell in reciprocal space, that is B1 times B2 cross B3, and this is equal to 2 pi cube divided by omega, and is therefore not vanishing, where omega is the volume of the unit cell in real space. So this shows that B1, B2, and B3 are linearly independent, since B1 times B2 cross B3 is not equal to zero, or this is the determinant of the matrix formed by B1, B2, and B3. So if the determinant of this matrix is not zero, the three vectors are linearly independent. Okay, so this is what we saw last time. And now I want to prove that indeed it is a Bravais lattice, the reciprocal lattice. Namely, that the vector of the reciprocal lattice are given all by G is equal to M1 B1 plus M2 B2 plus M3 B3 for any M1 M2 and M3 integer. So the vector G given by this expression are the solution and the only solution of exponential ijr is equal to 1. So these vectors are the only solution of exponential I j times r is equal to 1. So where r are the vectors of the Bravais lattice. So this is an affirmation to prove it. Well, I can write, so this for any r is equal to n1 a1 plus n2 a2 plus n3 a3 for any n1, n2, n3 integral. Okay, so if I want to prove that the vector g in this, are the only solution of that for the r belonging to the Bravais lattice, then I can write, so I can show it this way. Indeed, if I write a vector j in the most general form, I'm imposing from this. So I can always write a three-dimensional vector as g1 times a1 plus g2 times a2 plus g3 times a3, with g1, g2, and g3 any possible real number. So this is the most general way I can write the vector g. Since a1, a2, and a3 are linearly independent vectors, I can always write any vector in three dimensions this way. And if I impose that the j here must verify this for any r in the Bravais lattice. So if I impose that this j verifies exponential I j times r is equal to 1, which defines my reciprocal lattice. This is the way we defined it. All j that verify this. So if I write it that way, and this means that j times capital R must be equal to an integer times 2 pi. So I will calculate explicitly j times r. So my j is here, my r are here. And now when I do this product j times r, I use the fact that I have this equation that is bi times aj is equal to 2 pi delta ij. So the only part that will not give zero are b1 times a1, b2 times a2, and b3 times a3, because all the other b1 times a2 and so on are zero because of that relationship. Yes?
I'm just wondering, shouldn't it be g dot r such that g are written in terms of the bi's? Because it's going to be like the reciprocal lattice vectors times the real space vectors.
Oh, sorry. Yes, you're right. I meant B here, not A. Yes. absolutely, B1, B2, and B3.
Yes, sorry. Okay, so this is what I wanted to do. Okay, so I wrote my G vector in the most general form in terms of the B1, B2, and B3. And now I'm using this product, this relationship. And therefore, now I have G1 times N1 plus G2 times N2 plus G3 times N3. Okay, so this is the first part times 2 pi because of that. Okay. All right, you agree? Okay, so and if I write the vector G that verifies this condition in the most general possible way, I obtain that this must be equal, and because of this relationship, I must have G times R is equal to 2 pi times an integer. So this part must be equal to an integer, or must be integer for any n1, n2, and n3. I must have this, so I must have G times capital R is equal to an integer times 2 pi, and this must be valid for any vector R of the Bravais lattice vectors, so for any n1, n2, and n3. Okay? Now, obviously, I can, for instance, put N2 and N3 equal to 0. And then I find that G1 must be an integer, and the same for the other G2 and G3. So this being valid for any N1, N2, and N3 implies that G1 and G2 and G3 must be integers. So this proves that the only possible solution of this are these vectors. That is, G is equal to M1, B1, M2, B2, M3, B3. Okay? So these are the only possible solution. And these are, by the way it is written, it is from Bravais lattice. So the reciprocal lattice is a Bravais lattice. So this is the first thing I wanted to show, prove. And the second one is that the reciprocal lattice of a reciprocal lattice is the initial Bravais lattice. So the reciprocal lattice of a Bravais lattice is, well, if you take twice the reciprocal lattice, you go back to the initial Bravais lattice. So, the second property I wanted to state is that the reciprocal lattice of the reciprocal lattice is the original Bravais lattice. And Well, to show this, this means that the reciprocal lattice of the reciprocal lattice is the origin of Bravais lattice. So I want the R prime that are reciprocal lattice vector of the G that are the reciprocal of the set of vector R. So the conditions or the condition for the R primes for the corresponding R prime that would be the reciprocal lattice of the original Bravais lattice, so these are the R prime, is that exponential I R prime times G is equal to 1, where the G are the vector of the reciprocal lattice, so M1 V1 plus M2 V2 plus M3 V3 with M1, M2 and M3 integers. So clearly the R of the original Bravais lattice will verify this, and actually they are the only one because of the uniqueness of the reciprocal. I mean, there is a unique reciprocal lattice to a given Bravais lattice, but one can also just see it from the R primes, the R's, the vector R of the original Bravais lattice verify it, obviously. And no other R verify it. No other set of R verify it, because the conditions exponential I j times r and also the condition defining the primitive vectors are symmetric in the A and in between the real space and the reciprocal space. So this is symmetric in permuting R and G, and this is symmetric in permuting A and B. And therefore, there is a new unique reciprocal lattice to a given lattice. One could write the R prime the same way that I wrote here the J as R prime equal L1 A1 L2 A2 L3 A3. And one could then calculate R prime times J and would one obtain exactly the same thing, showing that L1, L2, and L3 should be integer, and therefore the R prime R equal to N1 A1 N2 plus N2 A2 plus N3 A3 with N1 N2 and N3 integer. So one can redo the same demonstration for the reciprocal lattice of the reciprocal lattice, so for these vectors R prime, and one would obtain the condition that these vectors must be equal to N1 plus N2 into B2, A2 plus N3 A3. So one can reverse the argument. So, and no other, because the conditions here are symmetric. Let me finish writing. Because these conditions are symmetric. Symmetric in R going to permuting R and J and A and B. And therefore, there is a unique reciprocal lattice to a given Bravais lattice G equal M1 B1 plus M2 B2 plus M3 B3 for any M1 M2 M3 integer, which is R prime is equal to N1 A1 plus N2 A2 plus N3 A3. Well, here I summarize everything to show it explicitly. But the point is that there is a unique reciprocal lattice to a given Bravais lattice. So if one do the reciprocal twice, one goes back to the initial Bravais lattice. But it can be proven explicitly by redoing what we did the first time to show that the J are in this form, and one can do the same for the R prime again. Okay, so this is the second property. The reciprocal lattice of the reciprocal lattice is the original Bravais lattice. Okay, everybody agrees? Okay. Now let's use that. So I just wanted to tell you what is the reciprocal lattice of some of the Bravais lattice we have seen. And some properties. So if I list some Bravais lattices that we have seen, the ansi also give you the reciprocal lattice and the corresponding reciprocal lattice. The FCC lattice, the face-centered cubic Bravais lattice, its reciprocal lattice will be the body-centered cubic lattice. And actually, as homework for next time, I want you to check that, to prove that. So I will give you that homework in a minute. So given that the reciprocal lattice of the FCC lattice is the BCC lattice, from what we have just seen, the reciprocal lattice of the BCC lattice will be the FCC lattice. So the reciprocal lattice of the BCC lattice is the FCC lattice. And the simple cubic lattice has as reciprocal lattice and also the simple cubic lattice. So this is what happens for this cubic type of lattices. So as homework, I would like you to show that the reciprocal lattice of the FCC lattice is the BCC lattice. So to show this, so verify as homework the property here. And to do that, you can first calculate or determine the primitive vector of the reciprocal lattice. So for the FCC lattice, you know the A1, A2, and A3. I give you the formula to calculate the B1, B2, and B3. So I'm asking you to determine this B vector and check that indeed they are the primitive vectors of a BCC lattice. And then I would like you also to calculate explicitly the volume of the resulting BCC lattice, so the reciprocal lattice, and to check what you know already in general, but you can see in this specific case that it gives the right result. So once you have calculated the BI, I would like you to check that B1 times B2 cross B3 is equal to 2 pi cube over omega, where omega is the volume of the unit cell of the FCC lattice. So, in this specific case, you can check that you obtain indeed the correct result for the volume of the BCC reciprocal space lattice of the unit cell. So, this B1, B2, and B3, this is the volume of the unit cell of in reciprocal lattice. Okay, so this is the homework for next time. Now, we have seen the properties of the unit cell in real space. Now the reciprocal lattice is a Bravais lattice, so the properties of the unit cell are the same. I mean, all the general properties that we have shown apply also for the reciprocal lattice. And in particular, one can also define the Wignerside cell of the reciprocal lattice. So among the various primitive unit cells of the reciprocal lattice, there is one which has some special symmetry property, which is unique, and which is the Wignerside cell of the reciprocal lattice. And this Wignerside cell of the reciprocal lattice is called the Brillouin zone. So, the Wignerside cell of the reciprocal lattice is some special object which we call the Brillouin zone. So the Wignerside cell of the reciprocal lattice is called the Brillouin zone. The Brillouin zone plays an important role in the description of the electronic state in a crystal, and we will come back to it after having introduced the Bloch theorem as a consequence of the Bloch theorem. This Wignerside cell of the reciprocal lattice will be very useful to label the Bloch state. Okay, so this is the end of the part on the crystal structure. So now I'm going to start a new part, which is that of the electronic state in a crystal. Any question? Yes.
Is it possible to have a lattice where you define all the unit or the primitive levels, and you can reach all points in the lattice, but the lattice is not a Bravais lattice?
What do you mean?
That is, you have the lattice with primitive vectors, and with those primitive vectors, you can locate every lattice point in that lattice.
I mean, you have three vectors in three dimensions?
Yes, three dimensions.
A1, A2, and A3?
And you can locate all the lattice points using those three vectors. Okay. But the lattice is not a Bravais lattice.
But by definition, it is.
I'm asking if it's possible.
Well, the definition of a Bravais lattice is that if you sum all possible n1, the first vector, n2, the second vector, and n3, the third vector, with n1, n2, and n3 integer, then you define the Bravais lattice, so it is a Bravais lattice. All right, so now I'm starting the next part, which is on the electronic state in a crystal. So, electronic state in crystals, this is the second part of the course. electronic state in crystals. So far we have seen the crystal structure, their property, the periodicity related to the Bravais lattice, and now we are putting electrons in such geometry, and we are asking the question, what are what are the properties of this wave function of the electron in a crystal, so in a system that has a Bravais lattice. So this is what we are now asking. So electron level. In a periodic potential. Created by the nuclei in my crystal. So I consider a potential, or let's say, well, yes. I consider a potential Vr, which is equal to Vr plus capital R, where capital R are all the vector of a given Bravais lattice. So I have a crystal with a given Bravais lattice. For simplicity, I consider a monoatomic crystal, so the atoms are positioned at each capital R, where capital R is the Bravais lattice. And this just to simplify, but what I'm going to tell you the main parts, in particular the Bloch theorem, is valid for any kind of crystal that has a given Bravais lattice, monoatomic, diatomic, or multiatomic. Okay, so I have, let's say, an arrangement of nuclei, which I draw as this positive charge in my crystal. So each of these nucleus has a charge Z, which is the atomic number, times the norm of E, the electronic charge. And okay, so I have a periodic arrangement of my nuclei. Here I'm showing columns of these atoms. And of course, the potential generated by such a periodic arrangement of nuclei has to have the periodicity of the nuclei, which is the Bravais lattice. So my V of R must be equal to V of R plus capital R, where capital R is any vector of the Bravais lattice of my crystal. I have to have a periodic potential in my crystal as a consequence of the periodic arrangement of the nuclei. So now, if I look, okay, I have my arrangement of atoms, and now I'm plotting the potential. Let's say I'm through a line here, which would be this line that passes through a row of atoms. So I have here an atom, I have another one, one nucleus, another one here, and so on. And this is my potential V of R. So these nuclei are going to create a Coulomb potential. So if I put these lines where my nuclei are positioned, I will have, if this one is positioned at the origin here, I will have a potential which will be minus z e squared over r. And for any capital R, let's say if this this atom is centered at the origin, this and the other are positioned at some vector capital R, this is the position of the nucleus, I will have a potential of the type minus z e squared over R minus capital R for any position of the ion in my crystal. So this potential will diverge at the origin or at the position of the nucleus, and then, okay, I can imagine something like that, since it must be periodic, it must be a superposition, linear superposition of such potential. They will diverge, become infinitively negative at the position of the nucleus, and I draw them this way. So this would be the potential created by my nuclei, let's say. Okay? I mean, it has to be Coulomb-type, centered on each of the ions, and I'm summing this type of potential. So this would be the bare potential created by the nuclei. But now I have also electrons in my system, so an electron will, electronic state will feel the mean field potential created by the other electrons. I mean. And since these potentials created by the nuclei are very attractive, the electron will concentrate in the region where the potential is very attractive. So one can imagine that if the electrons are concentrating near the nuclei, near this position, they will create a potential that is less attractive. They will screen it. So in taking into account also the electron-electron interaction, so the presence of the other electrons, taking into account the other electrons, in the end, I can expect that I will have a potential that will be less attractive here, so let's say like this, and then something like this, much smoother, due to the screening of the electrons. So the electron will concentrate here and will make the bare potential less attractive. They will create a negative charge here, which will induce some repulsion for the electron, and therefore adding these two the potential of the nuclei and of the electron here, the potential will be less attractive and behave, let's say, much more smoothly than the bare nucleus potential. Okay?
And that red graph is
It's the total. Sorry. Yeah. So with electron interaction, so it's the total potential, taking into account the electron and the nuclei in a mean field approximation. So the electrons accumulate in this region and they produce then a potential that added to the nuclei potential will be the red curve. Something of that type. So the potential, of course, the red potential is also periodic. We'll have also the periodicity of the Bravais lattice, given that the source, the nuclei, have this periodicity. They will induce an electronic charge distribution in the crystal that will have also this periodicity, and consequently also the potential created by this electronic distribution through Poisson's equation will have also the periodicity of the crystal. So one expects a potential that will have the periodicity of the crystal in the end. So we use the, as I mentioned at the beginning, the independent electron approximation. In this course, so a kind of mill field, the electron in a mill field potential, and we will solve the Schrödinger equation for a single electron Schrödinger equation.
Excuse me.
Yes?
So we define the general form of the potential. For now, like, let's forget about electron-electron interaction, mm-hmm. because I wanted to mention something.
Mm-hmm.
So Vr equals to Vr plus brilliant, like,
big capital vector of the Bravais lattice.
So we stay at some random r and we move for multiple r, we'll get the same potential. So
yes,
it can be readily seen. But let's say if we sit at let's say R1 for once,
mm-hmm.
R1, and if we move in both like left and right direction,
mm-hmm.
like because of the spherical nature of the potential,
yeah,
we'll see that after some time, like when it crosses the potential,
mm-hmm.
well, like the potential graph of the left and the right part, we'll also see the same potential.
Like you mean being symmetric with respect,
yes,
to the position,
yes,
of the
yes,
ion?
Ma'am.
Yes,
ma'am. Yes. But that is not seen in...
No, because it's not general.
Okay.
That is, imagine you go out from the monoatomic crystal and you go in a crystal like gallium arsenide. So you have an anion and a cation. So, and you have no inversion symmetry if you are centered on one of the atoms. So actually, this kind of symmetry is not robust, is not general. In some cases you have it, in our case you don't have it. Here I'm talking in general, and I have as unique, I mean, I'm considering just the Bravais lattice, which is a general property. The inversion symmetry is not always present.
Because the graph shows the
spherical
nature of the potential,
yeah,
but the
because
general definition of potential doesn't incorporate
science. Here I already went to some specific case. I went down to monoatomic crystal just to draw things. Yes, of course, very, very close to a nucleus, the potential is similar to that of the atom. But if you go a bit further and you have an environment which is not symmetric, then you lose also the inversion symmetry, for instance. So it depends on the crystal. These are things that... beyond the Bravais lattice. Have additional symmetries, but Yeah. Here we just consider the Bravais lattice, which is the most general feature. For instance, you can have Bravais lattices FCC with a single atom, and then you have inversion symmetry, like in aluminum. But you can have Bravais lattices which are FCC with two atoms in the cell, like gallium arsenide, and then you don't have any more the inversion symmetry.
Is it like mono, like diatomic or yeah, like multiatomic? Yeah, will yeah. The it then, will be a complex.
Yeah, but the Bravais lattice is more general. It's related to the periodicity, and this is that of the basis or the units of atoms you have, and the atom in the basis. So it can be 1, 2, and the symmetry can change when depending on that. But the Bravais lattice is robust, and this translational periodicity, I mean symmetry, is something we are discussing here and using here for the Bloch theorem. I mean, I'm going to go to the Bloch theorem with all this. So I'm just talking about the Bravais lattice, which is less restrictive than what one has in some crystal in terms of both the diamond and gallium arsenide have two atoms in the cell, but they have the same translational symmetry, Bravais lattice, but in one case you have a gallium and an arsenic, so it breaks some it's a bit different than when you have just carbon diamond.
And then one question. When we define the potential, we define it as a function of R vector. But in generally atoms, like since it's a central potential, it
is not dependent on theta. This is the crystal potential. Okay, maybe I went a bit too. This is the crystal potential. It will become more clear, I guess, later on. This is the crystal potential. So the crystal potential is this, and it's a superposition of, let's say, atomic potential on each of the atom in my crystal. What I'm claiming is that the sum of the atomic potential is periodic, has the periodicity of the Bravais lattice. Okay? So this is the full crystal potential, and here I'm just saying you that it's made from a superposition of atomic or nuclear potential centered on each of the atoms or nuclei. Okay? So this property is a property for the full potential, either the bare potential, that is the sum of the nuclear potential, or the screen potential, which is the that plus the potential generated by the distribution of the electronic charge, which via Poisson's equation is going to give an additional potential that screens this one and will, by the sum, give the red potential. But it will also have this periodicity. Okay, all right. So now I'm going to solve the Schrödinger equation for for a single particle. So H C of R is equal to the kinetic part, so minus h bar square Laplacian divided by 2 and E, the mass of the electron, plus this potential, my crystal potential, V of R. So in general, I will have to solve this. Is equal to epsilon V of R. So the one electron Schrödinger equation with here the crystal potential. So this is a general, I mean, this type of Schrödinger equation for one electron is rather general, and one finds it in particular using density functional theory, which is a general theory widely used to calculate from first principle the electronic structure of crystals. So, and probably you'll see it next semester, maybe from in the course of Ali Hassanali on biosystem. I guess he will also mention density functional theory. So, in particular, this form, one would find it from density functional theory, that is a one electron type of Schrödinger equation in density functional theory. And using the local density approximation, which is widely used to solve in practice the electronic state in a crystal, local density approximation. So using the local density approximation, one would have an equation of the type of that. This I'm just telling you things so you know that one will in practice indeed solve this type of equation. So within density functional theory, one would have a potential of the type. So the first part is just the, let's say, the potential created by the nuclei. So Z is the atomic number, E squared over R minus RI. So a superposition of Coulomb potential centered on each of the nuclei in the crystal, plus integration in space, the R prime cube. E square times the electronic charge density, rho of R, divided by R minus R prime. So this is the potential created by the charge density, which gives you this repulsive potential for the electron. So more or less the red thing, that is the electronic charge will create this type of potential at the position R through Poisson's equation, this is what one would get as potential. And in density functional theory, there is an additional potential, which is the exchange correlation potential, so XC for exchange correlation, which takes into account what has been neglected by considering independent electrons, really completely independent electrons. So there is an exchange part that comes from the antisymmetrization of the wave function, and the correlation part that includes everything that is beyond Hartree-Fock. So basically this part, it can be proven from density functional theory that it depends on the electronic charge density. So this is the general form within density functional theory of the potential in this one electron Schrödinger equation. So you don't need to use this, but it's just to tell you that also within DFT, one would get a potential, I mean, an equation of that type. So that's just the message. So here the Ri, I forgot to mention, are the position of the nuclei. Of the nucleus. Each of the nuclei. So, oops, no, I forgot the prime here. Okay. So, integration over R prime of the electronic charge density divided by R minus R prime. Okay, alright, so this is within density functional theory. Now, in practice, there is something this is within density functional theory using the local density approximation, so it depends locally on the charge density, not non-locally like here. That is, and the potential at the point R depend on the charge density rho of R. So this is the local approximation. Non-local would be that it depends on all R prime, the density on all points around R prime. So. Okay, so in practice, apart from local density approximation, one uses another approximation, which is actually very good. In most cases, it is that the core electrons are so tightly bound to the nucleus, to the nuclei, their binding energy is so large, of the order of 50 eV, which is extremely large compared to the binding energy, let's say, of the valence electron, which weighs 1 eV or of the order of 1 eV, that one consider basically that the core electrons are like in the atoms, and one solve just for the valence electron. So in practice, the core electrons are so tightly bound in the crystal, they are too so tightly bound to the nuclei. It is their binding energy is much larger in magnitude than that of the valence electron. The that basically the core electron remain essentially like in the atom when they are in the crystal. In practice, the core electrons are so tightly bound with binding energy that are the order of 50 eV or larger, so much more bound than the valence electron that one considers basically that they are like in the atom, and one source only for the valence electrons, the equations. So, so they remain like the like in the atom, and one solves for the valence electrons only. So typically, one source for potential, effective potential of the type V of R equals sums over the position of the nuclei or ion, an atomic potential for the valence electron, which is centered on the atom, plus in a density functional theory, the integration of the Coulomb potential produced by the valence charge. Plus the exchange correlation potential produced by the valence electron. For instance, if you consider and this potential, this atomic potential, if one goes a little bit further away from the core electron, which are very, very close to the nucleus, basically this potential is a Coulomb potential beyond a certain distance with a charge that corresponds to the charge of the nucleus minus the charge of the electron, or, well, plus, I mean, if you take the nucleus charge positive and you add the charge of the core electron, then you obtain the Coulomb with that charge, a Coulomb potential which describes the behavior of the potential that is felt by the valence electron. So this atomic potential, which also, or pseudo potential, is a long range, a Coulomb potential associated with the ion charge that is given by Z minus the number of core electrons. So beyond a certain radius, which is that of the core electron, this potential is a Coulomb potential with that ion charge. And this is the potential that acts on the valence electron in this in the Schrödinger equation for the valence state. You can see it easily if here you replace for the core electron the charge density by a delta function. So you assume, if you assume the core electrons are so localized in space that one can see their potential as their charge as a delta function, if you replace the delta function here, you obtain exactly a Coulomb potential here that has this charge. And when it's not exactly a delta function, the core charge, then you have close to the atom, close to the nucleus, some deviation from a Coulomb potential, but further away it becomes exactly a Coulomb potential with that charge generated by that charge. So, okay. So this is what usually one solves, that is a Schrödinger equation for the valence state in the crystal. The core state, one assumes they are like in the atom. All right, so so in general, I use the name pseudo-potential because in band structure calculation, one often uses the pseudo-potential approximation with this potential that one obtains actually from calculation, Schrödinger calculation, density functional calculation just for a single atom. And this potential, this pseudo-potential, includes the effect of the core electron, of their charge, but also the orthogonalization, because as you know, the states in the hydrogen atom or in an atom have to be orthogonal between each other. So the valence state have to be orthogonal to the core state. And in calculations using just the Schrödinger equation for the valence electron, one uses pseudo-potential that also include this effect. That is, they are repulsive in the region where they are the core states, and they simulate also the orthogonalization to the core state. Okay, this is just parenthesis. I'm using the word pseudo-potential because it is actually a type of potential that we are using in practice for calculating band structure. Okay, so now I want to introduce the Bloch theorem, which applies in the case of periodic potential. All what I have shown you here is just to tell you what kind of potential one has in practice. But now I'm going more general, and I use only the fact that it has some periodicity, that of the gravity lattice. So now I'm introducing the Bloch theorem. I will state the Bloch theorem, which is the central theorem we will use in that course. So the Bloch theorem states that the solutions of the Schrödinger equation HC is equal to epsilon C with H, the Hamiltonian, minus H bar square Laplacian over 2m E plus V of R. So the solution of the Schrödinger equation with this Hamiltonian and the potential V of R periodic. With the periodicity of the Bravais lattice, that is V of R plus capital R is equal to V of R for any vector R belonging to the Bravais lattice. So the solution of the Schrödinger equation with a potential that has the periodicity of the Bravais lattice can be written in the form Pk of R is equal to exponential I k R times uk of R. So this is called a Bloch function. And in this Bloch function, this apart from this exponential, the part u is periodic. So u, where uk of r is periodic. With the periodicity of the Bravais lattice. That is U of R plus capital R, a Bravais lattice vector, is equal to UK of R. So the Bloch theorem states that the solution of the Schrödinger equation with a potential that has the periodicity, the periodicity of the Bravais lattice, can be written in this form with an exponential here times a function u of r, which is periodic. This is the general form that the eigenstate of a crystal should have or have. So, is the Bloch function in general, does the Bloch function or the, according to this theorem, the solution of a crystal potential, does it has always the periodicity of the Bravais lattice of the crystal, given the theorem? Is this function in general periodic with the periodicity of the Bravais lattice, or not? Not in general. Yes. No.
Yes.
K is a vector, a real vector. I mean, not the has three components, k1, k2, and k3, which are real numbers in general. I mean, the theorem does tell you that it can be written in this general form. This is the general form of the solution of the Schrödinger equation for a crystal.
I think like we'll have a conditional k, because there will be an extra factor e to the power I k dot big r. So there has to be a condition on k that is equals to 1. So
okay.
If you want it to be periodic, then there will be a condition on k dot r.
It can be periodic, but is it periodic in general? So that's the question. I mean, actually,
because if that condition is satisfied, the second part u is periodic. So
yes, but the first part, does it have the periodicity of the Poincaré lattice in general, with k1, k2, k3? Real numbers. No. So the solution, the eigenstate of Hamiltonian, which is periodic, actually the Bloch theorem says that they don't need to be periodic. Do you know other examples that you have seen where something similar happens? That is, for instance, if you consider the hydrogen atom, the potential has, for instance, a symmetry which is the inverse of symmetry. If you transform R into minus R, the potential remains the same. It's a spherical potential, and therefore the Hamiltonian is invariant if one changes, if one applies the inversion symmetry. Do the solution have also this symmetry, that is, they are invariant if one goes from R to minus R?
Actually, I think R comes at the power of epsilon, so I'm sorry, E. Okay.
No, I'm talking about, okay. Here, the theorem says the solution don't have the periodicity of the crystal, which is a symmetry, a kind of symmetry property, the translational symmetry. You translate and you get the same potential. So I'm telling you that in the hydrogen atom, also it's a spherical potential, therefore it's invariant under inversion symmetry. That is, if you apply the operation R, the inversion symmetry, you remain with the same Hamiltonian. Is it the same for all the eigenstate of the hydrogen? No.
I think one of the solutions is e to the 1 minus R by A, so it is definitely not.
So some are even under the inversion symmetry and some are odd. Okay, so here actually it's very similar. That is what is behind the Bloch theorem is actually that given the Hamiltonian commutes with the translation of Bravais lattice, so the symmetry operation that translate by a Bravais lattice vector, then given the Hamiltonian commute with the translation symmetry, the eigenstate of the Hamiltonian can be simultaneously eigenstate of the translational operator. It's the same in the hydrogen atom. The hydrogen atom, the Hamiltonian commutes with the inversion symmetry, and therefore the eigenstates are either even or odd with respect to the inversion symmetry. P states are odd. That is, if you apply the inversion symmetry on a P state, it transforms it into minus itself, so with an eigenvalue minus 1. Instead, if you apply the inversion symmetry to an S state, it transforms it into itself, and so with eigenvalue 1. And here, actually, it's the eigenstate of the hydrogen atom are either even or odd eigenstate of the inversion symmetry, because inversion symmetry commutes with the hydrogen atom Hamiltonian. Here, the crystal Hamiltonian commutes with the translation operation that translates by a Bravais lattice vector. And therefore, the solution of the Hamiltonian, or crystal Hamiltonian, actually are eigenstate of the translational operation, where the translation are translation by Bravais lattice vectors. So it's something similar, and it's correct that the eigenstate should not be invariant under translation of the, by the, should not have the periodicity of the Bravais lattice vector, because they are eigenstate, but not necessarily with the eigenvalue 1. They are other eigenvalues. Okay, so basically, the Bloch theorem is just, this is just stating that the eigenstates of the crystal Hamiltonian can be chosen to be simultaneously simultaneous eigenstate of the translation operator T, which I call TR, for which are the translation by Bravais lattice vectors, so R belonging to the Bravais lattice. So what the Bloch theorem states is that the this function, the eigenstate of the crystal, are eigenstate of the translation operators. So if I apply on Bloch state, I mean on a state if I apply the translation operation on a Bloch state that is written in this way, I'm obtaining the translated wave function by definition. So if I apply a translation of a Bravais lattice vector to this state, I define it as psi k of R plus capital R, I'm obtaining for a Bloch state exponential e k R plus capital R uk of R plus capital R, and this is equal to exponential I k capital R times exponential I k R uk of R, which is nothing but my initial Bloch state. So this is just Ck of R. So the Bloch state, Ck of R, R eigenstate of the translational operator, that is, if I apply a translation to a Bloch state, I obtain the Bloch state type a phase, which is the eigenvalue. So this state, the Bloch state, are nothing else than eigenstate of the translation operator with as eigenvalue, actually exponential I k capital R, where capital R is the vector of the translation operator, the Grave lattice vector corresponding to a given translation. So this is the constant phase. So this is a constant phase which corresponds to the eigenvalue of the translation operator. The eigenvalue, the eigenstate of the translation operator is the Bloch state, and the eigenvalue is exponential ikr. So k of R. Eigenstate. Of the translation operator for any and the eigenvalue is exponential I k r. It's so this k is a kind of good quantum number associated with the translation operator.
Yes? Maybe miss out the U of the U sub K of R.
Oops. Yeah. So basically, the Bloch theorem is just stating that given the Hamiltonian commutes with the translation corresponding to translation by the Grave lattice vectors, the eigenstate of the crystal Hamiltonian can be written as simultaneously eigenstate of the translational operator. So it writes the the general form of the crystal solution, the state that a solution of the crystal Hamiltonian can be written as eigenstate of the translation operator. Now, there is an equivalent form to the Bloch theorem that is just this, that is, it's the second way of stating the Bloch theorem is to state that the solution Ck are such that when one applies a translation, Ck of R plus capital R, it's equal to exponential I k R times Ck of R for any R belonging to the Bravais lattice vector. So the second way of stating Bloch's theorem is just stating it in this form, that is the crystal solution, when one applies the translation operation, it gives the same state. So it's an eigenstate of the translation operator with as eigenvalue exponential ekr. So this is an equivalent way of stating Bloch's theorem, the second form of Bloch's theorem. Just that these are the eigenstate of the translation operator with this eigenvalue. Okay, any question?
Translation operator have an explicit value or an explicit expression?
Not in the no. Just its action. You can write it for. For an infinitesimal translation, yes, but not for, one knows its action. Okay, all right, stop here.